Ryan Bell is here today. Ryan received his Master's of Divinity degree from Andrews University in Berrien Springs, Michigan, and a Doctor of Ministry in Missional Leadership from Fuller Theological Seminary in Pasadena. For 19 years, Ryan was a pastor, most recently the senior pastor right down the street here at the Hollywood Seventh-day Adventist Church. In March, last March, a year ago March, he resigned due to theological and practical differences. Now as an adjunct professor, he has taught subjects ranging from intercultural communication to bioethics. Currently, he is a researcher, writer, and speaker on the topic of religion and irreligion in America. In January, Ryan began a year-long journey exploring the limits of theism and atheist landscape in the United States, and he blogs about that experience at Year Without God. Please welcome Ryan Bell.
Thank you so much, Jim. Thank you for having me here today. I knew religious people got up at, you know, an unreasonable time of day on a Sunday morning and went to church. I'm frankly surprised to know that so many secular people get up at a similar time to come hear somebody talk. So I'm truly honored that you would sacrifice your Sunday morning. As Jim said, I used to be the pastor of the Hollywood Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is probably about a mile from here, straight down Hollywood Boulevard, just before you get to the 101 freeway on the right-hand side. It's kind of a cool or disgusting, depending on your viewpoint, particular piece of modern architecture. So we've had a lot of fans of the architecture. The church folk don't usually love it, but people that like architecture usually really like it. And I spent about 8 years in that congregation, and it was a fantastic experience for me. It was a place, it was sort of, I knew going into it 9 years ago that it would be my last stop with the church. I didn't know it would be my last stop with Christianity, but I knew that it would be my last stop with the Adventist Church, just because I had sort of worked my way into a corner in terms of the theological framework of Seventh-day Adventist Christianity. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Seventh-day Adventist Church or have some background. Anybody happen to be a former Seventh-day Adventist or a current Seventh-day Adventist? All right. So that are willing to admit it. So it was a great experience for me because it was a church that allowed me to really explore, as I said, the limits of theism, the limits. I wasn't even really thinking about theism at the time. I was really thinking about the limits of Christianity and how Christianity might be useful to the world in the postmodern age. And we did some useful things, I hope, while I was there. But eventually the church, and by the church I mean the denomination, not the local church, decided that I was no longer Seventh-day Adventist enough to be a pastor of that church. And so through some persuading, they convinced me that I should resign. I should have probably done that a long time before. And I can definitely say that my psychological health has improved since that time. I mean that seriously. It was a real tension, as any of you who have been through that kind of experience can testify, holding disparate ideas together when they don't fit together. So late last December, I decided to try on atheism. And when I wrote that, I put little quotes around try on in the hopes of indicating that I knew that it wasn't quite like, you know, putting on a jacket. And immediately people rightly, you know, pointed out that you couldn't really try that on. And I think what I didn't and have space to say at that one moment at the end of last year, which I hope I've said more on my blog and in the talks that I've given, what I didn't have time to say then was that I was not trying on atheism from a place of robust faith where I was pretending not to believe. It was more that I had come to the end of my faith for a variety of reasons and felt that some kind of worldview beyond theism was going to have to be my future, and I wanted to give it some time and explore that. I find that anything I do with any seriousness, I like to research, you know? So I didn't want to jump from one thing to the next, and I'll explain more about that in a minute. So I wanted to gradually move into whatever I was going to do next. And I had already been making this gradual evolution over a long period of time from strong fundamentalist faith in my childhood and my college years to a place of very liberal faith in my professional life, which also took place over a fairly long period of time, to seriously suspecting in the last 3 or 4 years that I had lost my faith. So I decided to take this year and explore the worldview of atheism and the many features of non-theist way of looking at the world. And as you can imagine, there are many differences. Most of them fall under the broad heading of reality versus a sort of faith-based way of looking at the world. And I had really grown weary of trying to augment reality, if you will, with faith. I knew what my eyes told me, and I knew what my personal relationships were telling me. And then I had this other component of the Bible and faith that, you know, theology, in my, you know, my view, is that work of trying to fit those two things together. Theology, there are so many volumes of theological writing because theologians have to take the ancient text and try to make it fit with a modern world. And the longer we, you know, the more time elapses between the time when those texts were written and today, the more words it takes to make those things fit together. And I, you know, as crazy as that sounds, and it sounds like I'm, you know, being flippant, and I'm really trying hard not to be flippant about that, it's actually a lot of fun. You know, theology, for someone who's studied theology, is a lot of fun. It's like studying any ancient text and trying to make sense of it, really, I think. And the difference being with Christians is that it has to be true in some sense for them right now. So that makes the job a little bit harder than, you know, simply studying Beowulf, for example, and just trying to understand what was going on. So today I'd like to share some of the things I've learned so far this year, and I want to do that by way of sharing 5 reasons why I chose to spend a year in between. Because one of the big questions has been, you know, why do this in between thing? Aren't you already an atheist? There's basically 2 things. Aren't you already an atheist? You're just kidding us. And or you were never really a Christian to begin with. Or aren't you really a Christian trying to just weasel your way into the skeptic community and then tell us all how stupid we are? So all of those are various conjectures of why, you know, I have chosen to do this way. And to be completely honest with you, I had no idea about all of those motives when I first did it. I just literally said to a friend over some Thai noodles, I think I'm going to spend next year as an atheist. And he said, you should do that and write about it. And I said, maybe I will. And by the end of the day, I had purchased a URL and decided to start blogging. So that's about how much forethought went into the project. It wasn't until inquiring minds started asking what I was up to that I had to ask myself what I was up to. So let me share these 5 reasons with you. And then at the end, hopefully we can do some Q&A, because I was saying to Jim earlier, this is my favorite part of the time, is just interacting with you. So to do that, I want to say, first of all, I chose to spend this year in between because I find it to be a generative place. And this idea of this in-between space for me is highly informed by this word liminality. It's a relatively recent word in the popular lexicon, but the root word for liminal or liminality is the word limen, which literally translates to threshold. It's that part of your door frame that you step over when you go in your house. And it was first used by a French ethnographer named Arnold Van Gennep, who invented the term and used it in his book in 1908, his book Rites of Passage. And he uses this idea of liminality to describe rituals and rites of pre-modern tribes of people whose young people are going through the rite of passage of being from a child to being an adult. In the 1960s, Victor Turner, the anthropologist Victor Turner, rediscovered and popularized this term. And in its original context, liminality, as he says as well, is applied to rituals in these small-scale societies. The word was originally coined to describe coming of age And this idea of a child who is neither this nor that, no longer a child, but not yet an adult. You can sort of picture a very generalized scenario where a young boy is reaching the age of adulthood, whatever the age that is in that culture, and is sent out of the safe confines of the community to accomplish some feat and come back successful, and upon his return, he's now a man. So this liminal space is this in-between space, the space in which the young boy is no longer a boy because he's left the safety of his family, but he's no longer a man because he's not yet accomplished the thing that will make him a man. That's just one example of what Turner talks about. So liminality in a broader sense then, for me, describes the space of unknowing, an in-between space, when a person or a society is neither this nor that, but in some vague, indeterminate space in between. It's an experience of profound disruption for a person or for a society. The old has passed away, but the new has not yet come into focus. It's the experience that we usually describe with the prefix post, post-Christian, post-Enlightenment, post-modern. And I think this is one of the reasons why right-wing Christians in particular, and even some of the more moderate evangelicals, are trying so hard to hold back the tides of change, because they are fearful of crossing this threshold. It isn't about family values, really, or biblical values, or the safety and security of America, so much as it is about social control and the loss of power that groups, in particular in this case, conservative and evangelical Christians, feel as the world, and especially as the United States, pluralizes. A group of people who have held dominance in that society are losing their grip on that dominance. And so this is a deep anxiety expressed primarily, let's just name it, by white, middle class, upper middle class, conservative Christians. And it's essentially the anxiety felt from this loss of power and loss of control. The reality is that the public square must be shared, and the people used to being in the ascendancy are not so comfortable with that sharing and the giving up of power that they've had to experience. I say all that to say that my experience over the past year has been a personal experience of liminality, of this betwixt and between, as Victor Turner says, neither here nor there, without the structures of support one finds in either place. In coming-of-age rituals, the experience is like being a non-person, of dissolving into the background noise. Turner invokes the image of a caterpillar becoming a moth or a butterfly. As you probably know, the caterpillar, before it becomes a butterfly, sort of digests itself and becomes caterpillar soup and then reorganizes itself, I almost want to say miraculously, into a butterfly. The analogy for me is apt. It's this disorganization of one's worldview and then reorganization of a new worldview, often out of the same component parts that were there before, only into a completely different end product. And so I've had this feeling of being neither here nor there. Clearly, I think the most obvious part of this is that I don't feel comfortable as I used to among the people that were my tribe, among Christians, among Seventh-day Adventists in particular. I haven't had that many opportunities to feel out of place among Seventh-day Adventists. I honestly haven't been invited to be in their midst. Although last weekend I was invited to speak to a small group of liberal, progressive Adventists, and they were lovely and wonderful, and I was really grateful to be there. But I also have been to the American Atheist Convention this last year in Utah. I've been to a new startup skeptic group in North Carolina called ReasonCon, and a few other local small meetups. And whenever I'm there, I also have a hard time fully connecting to the enthusiasm of being really, really sure about your worldview, just being confident. It's a place that everybody grows into, hopefully, in their life, where you've been around the barn enough times with all the questions, and that you feel quite comfortable and quite at home among a group of people that you think of as your people. But when you're new in that world, it's hard to fully take it on when you're not, when you don't feel like you quite belong there either. So that's that feeling of being out of place, right? Of being, perhaps it would be like being at your in-laws or future in-laws' home for the first time. You know, you feel very connected to your partner, but you don't quite feel like you belong in their house, in their home. You're kind of like on edge, making sure that you're not doing something stupid or being judged, or you know what I mean? So that's that feeling of not fitting, quite fitting in. Although after many years, you probably feel like you fit in much more, hopefully, with your in-laws. But I digress. So liminality is a really creative space, I've found. This place of in-between, it's painful and awkward and uncomfortable, but it's also very creative, and it's a space where you can learn perhaps some of the most important things you'll ever learn in your life. It's a space worth inhabiting rather than rushing through. It's a deconstructive space, but it's also a reconstructive space. And so the temptation is to jump from one certainty to another, which brings me to the second reason I decided to spend a year in between, which is that we can so easily become the thing that we despise. So especially for Christians, and especially for people who have trafficked in certainty, it's tempting to jump from one certainty to another. So to me, there are essentially two kinds of atheists who used to be Christians. There are those who were fundamentalists and really experienced a lot of abuse at the hands of fundamentalist Christianity and said, forget it, I'm leaving, and become atheists. Then there's people that are more in my category who have gradually, over 20 years, slid out of Christianity, trying to make Christianity stretch to fit all of the new data that comes our way as we get older and experience more of life, and then finally the thing doesn't stretch anymore. Or as I like to say, it finally stretches to include everything, and then you're like, well, let's just call it everything then. Why do we have to have a special name for it? So I found that my effort to make Christianity more and more inclusive, finally I just came to the place where I didn't see the need for like a special thing. You know, we just, you know, love one another, as we've been taught by any wise person who has ever lived. And so I think for those who have really been abused at the hands of fundamentalist religion of any kind, the temptation, and maybe even the necessity, is to jump out of that into another type of certainty. And so I wanted to avoid that. Even though that wasn't exactly my story, I did experience, and still, through all of my friends who are still trying to convince the Seventh-day Adventist Church to ordain women to be pastors. This is the hot issue in the Seventh-day Adventist Church right now. There was an article posted in one of the online journals about female headship and how women are trying to assert their headship over men, and this has got to be stopped. And I thought, only within the Adventist Church could we even seriously have this conversation. It's just beyond the pale. So I don't want to... make these leaps. And I'm sometimes concerned that atheism is too easily defined by what it's opposing. Letting fundamentalist Christianity and Islam set the agenda, movement atheism can easily become its mirror image. And I think these harsh critiques of fundamentalist religion are valid and worth doing and need to be articulated. And then my hope is, at least for myself personally, I can move on to something else that's constructive and more productive. I would hate to see a movement as full of promise as free thought and skeptic movements be completely obsessed by sort of being the mirror image of the thing that it wants to oppose. And so I was keenly aware of Christianity's tendency to do this. This is one of the reasons I'm sensitized to this, because for years and years, my Seventh-day Adventism was largely defined by what we were not. We were not Catholics, for sure. Like, that would be the worst thing. Even though the irony is, as is always the case, there were elements of that kind of hierarchical Catholic framework at play within Seventh-day Adventism. We were clearly not, Catholics were the big problem. And any other cult. And I hope it's not too early on a Sunday morning to appreciate the irony of all of this, but there was a lot of effort put into describing the cultic, extreme, hierarchical, religious abuse from everybody else but us. And this is true not just of Adventists, but of anybody, really. And so it was, for me, the Catholic philosopher René Girard who first introduced me to this idea of mirroring, or he called, the way he describes it is what he calls mimetic violence, this idea that when we engage in violent backs and forths, whether it's physical violence of war or whether it's rhetorical violence, we can very quickly become the flip side of the thing that we're criticizing and condemning. And I'm just aware of that as a theologian. I was aware of that, and so stepping into this world, I'm aware of that possibility. I know many of my tweets and Facebook updates and even some blog posts have been reactionary as well. And sometimes anger is the appropriate response, and some bullshit really does need to be exposed and condemned. You know, probably on a daily basis, there's something worth saying no to. But on the whole, I don't want the rest of my life to be defined by the thing that I think is destructive. I want to be a part of cutting a new path and helping to continue cutting a path that's been cut for many years before. And I knew that my challenging relationship with my own Christian denomination, because of that, people would say that I'm just hurt. I knew that given my background being dismissed from the church, that people would say that my exploration of atheism was a reaction to my previous experience. And frankly, I don't see how anybody's life could be anything more or less than a response to what happened yesterday or in your life before. I mean, we're all living out of the experiences that we had. So on one level, absolutely, my exploration of atheism this year has been in response to the experiences that I've had as a Christian. But I do want to put a pause on the accusation that, and I think what's usually behind those types of accusations is that these responses are merely emotional. And there's a lot of problems with that. One is that the idea that our emotions are not sort of valid sort of experiences to which we would respond. But it also dismisses the idea that there are serious intellectual and theological problems that so many people have and that need to be taken seriously. So I did not want to be pegged as little as possible as that kind of reactionary person. On the other hand, I was hurt and I was angry, not even just for what happened to me personally, but for the injustice of the whole thing and for the people that I left behind in the church, many of whom just couldn't muster the courage to break free and speak their truth to the powers that be. So because it was painful and I didn't want my very real, unemotional concerns to get lost, I didn't want my loss of faith to be blamed on just feeling sad or, look, I was hurt by the church I served for a better part of 20 years. So if I was, you know, if that experience was going to make me an atheist, I think it would have done it before then. And because there were so many broken relationships as a result of my leaving the church, I knew I ran the risk of being reactionary. And so the second reason I've taken this in-between time is that I didn't want to be reactionary. I didn't want to rashly or hastily jump into the next thing, and I didn't want to become the thing that I was trying to leave in just in a mirror image sort of way. The third reason that I decided to do this year-long experience was because I strongly suspect that the most important answers that we're seeking lie beyond theism versus atheism. Alain de Botton, in the opening pages of his book, Religion for Atheists, said the most boring and unproductive question one can ask of any religion is whether or not it is true. He goes on to say in the next sentence or two, let's just get out of the way that no religion that claims all of these things is true. Okay, there we've said it. Now, let's talk about, you know, what's really important, which is how we're going to live our lives as human communities in ways that preserve the planet for future generations and create possibilities and opportunities for every person that shares this planet with us. And so that, for me, is a much more interesting proposal and interesting proposition. I found that I could fairly quickly dispense with the arguments for traditional theism. Without intending to, I think I had already dispensed with the notion of God while I was still a pastor. I didn't really talk about it very much, although we did do a kind of Lenten experience of atheism for the last 3 years I was there. I don't have time to describe that to you, but suffice it to say that there was at least one sermon a year where it was called God is Dead. I have a couple friends who experienced that with me who are here today. And we had a really profound ritual of having people bring to church that morning their unanswered prayers and their disappointments with God. The problem for me was it was hard for me to then turn up on Easter Sunday because I didn't have, like, I didn't know what to do with Easter Sunday because I was very clear about the first part. I was really unclear, you know, about the second part. So I think, well, even while I was a pastor, I dispensed with a lot of those arguments for the beingness or the ontology of God. And I had already moved to this sort of post-ontological concept of God, although I had no idea even now what that means exactly. It sounds fancy, and there are books about it, trust me, but it's really hard to conceive of that. And furthermore, it's hard to know like why that would matter. But that's not today's topic. So the really important question for anyone who professes atheism, that is freely and publicly declares that they do not believe in God, is now what? And for the better part of this year, as people have been telling me exactly what should come next in their opinion, I've been trying to hold the middle space, the space of not knowing. Not because I was afraid to commit, but because I was afraid I would commit too quickly. Not because I didn't have any ideas at all of what should come next, but because I was pretty sure I hadn't thought of the really important movements that should come next. And sometimes when we quickly latch on to the next new thing, we foreclose the possibilities that might lie just around the next corner. I think this is, in some ways, just simply the scientific method, isn't it? Like if we conclude something too quickly, we might be missing elements of something else that's at play that a little bit more patience and a little bit more due diligence would reveal. So determining that all the gods that have been proposed do not exist or are so far beyond the realm of discovery is a fairly simple task, I think. Understanding that the god of deism, for example, is of no use to us is not that complicated. In fact, I'm really surprised that people like, it's just as well, I can't remember his name, spend so much time defending, you know, cosmological arguments for God's existence, because at the end of the day, I just have no idea of what use that God is to anyone. I'd almost prefer, I mean, to me, that God is worse than no God. And so I would almost rather there not be a God like that. But the reality is that we, you know, once we've gone through all of that and sort of explored this, you know, the questions of the arguments for God, the reality is that we live here among this group of people with this struggling planet and this economic inequality. What story will non-believers organize their lives around? And of course, humanism comes to mind, right? But humanism is a baby movement, as religious movements go. It holds great promise, but it doesn't have the long history and tradition of the major world religions. And so we're building it right now. And it's an exciting time to be alive. I'm energized by the possibilities that are in front of us as we think about more and more people leaving their faith. There was just an article about, many articles, about how the Mormon church has had to come clean about some of Joseph Smith's practices because of the internet, you know, because internet. So we have, you know, more and more people who cannot hide anymore from the reality. And as that happens, more and more people are going to be joining the numbers of us who cannot hold our faith the way that we used to in the past. And, you know, I'm a community organizer at heart. And I like, what are we going to do with all these people? We could make a difference. And this is what really animates me. A fourth reason that I've spent this time in between is because so many people are in between and don't know what to do. This is actually a reason that evolved later on and during the year. This was not a reason at all for why I launched this idea, this project in the first place. I didn't even think of it as a project, honestly. But as the project unfolded and more people, literally thousands of people have written to me, and I've saved every email, people have written to me and said, I'm exactly where you are. And then they would say, well, but probably not exactly, but you know what I mean. I'm right where you are, having lost my faith, only mine was 3 years ago. Or, you know, maybe 6 months into mine, you know, they would say, just yesterday I came to this realization and I found your blog and I'm just right in this place where you are, where I don't know what to do. Just as recently as earlier this week, or last week, I got an email from a young man whose journey out of his religion mirrors my own so closely that it was just uncanny. And I asked him if I could share a portion of his email with you. This is just a little of what he wrote to me. For the past year, I, and I'm assuming you, have been stuck in the lonely middle. I have not left my theist friends or family. I still love them dearly. But there is a certain distance that has grown between us. It's not like a minor political or philosophical difference. It's the worldview on which all philosophical and moral decisions rest. On the other hand, I am quite hesitant to join any kind of atheist movement, he puts in quotes, as I find their movements at times too hyperbolic and smug for my taste. Instead, I find myself in the middle, unable to believe the religion I've left, but unwilling to hate it either. Now, I don't know if you can relate to that or not. Probably, you know, most of you here today have never had an experience like that, or are so far removed from yours that you might be thinking to yourself, he'll hate it soon enough. just give a little bit more time. And maybe that's true. But right now, that's where he's at, right? That's his testimony. That's his experience. He's in this place, torn between his family and his past and his future and where he's at right now. I've become friends with a guy over the telephone who went to the same seminary. He's still at the same seminary where I used to go. And we've been talking about his loss of faith. He dropped out of the seminary. His family are devout, devout Seventh-day Adventist believers. And he's now an atheist. And he phones me once in a while and says, what am I going to do? And I find myself in a pastoral role, ironically, you know, trying to talk to him and tell him I have no idea what to do, which is what I did when I was a pastor. Finally, I've embarked on this in-between sort of journey because it's uncomfortable. And most of the really important things in my life I've learned when I was in the midst of discomfort. This journey has taught me more about discomfort and pain than probably any other experience in my life and the experiences that have clustered around it. I was just thinking of my children this morning as I was getting ready to come here and what a challenge it's been for them. I wrote on my blog a few days ago about my youngest daughter who said to me, it was just the weirdest timing, you know, we were just like in Target looking at something and she blurted out, Daddy, I don't want you to be an atheist after this year is over. And I was like, oh, crap. I was like, well, why? Why not? She's like, I just don't. I'm like, well, what does it mean to you? What does it mean to you for me to be an atheist? Well, she didn't know. She just knew that it was not the way things were before. And that made her sad. It makes me sad. It's painful. These things are, the roots go deep. And when people uproot, they're in a very vulnerable, but also a very generative place where a lot of good can happen. So this sojourn has made me uncomfortable. You don't belong anywhere. You leave your people behind. At the same time, you don't have a new people to exactly identify with. You're in a new country without your tribe, without a clear identity, and that pain of separation is very real. But it also makes the onlookers uncomfortable. The people on the other shore, those watching a person push off from the shore at point A, feel the anxiety. Someone they've known and trusted is leaving the safe shores of the places they've lived and where they've gathered with others. They're generally fearful for your life. The people at point A may fear for the person's safety, concerned that they won't make it back unharmed or won't come back at all. But the people at point B may be suspicious of the motives of the person approaching from the sea. Is this traveler that's approaching our shores friend or foe? Some trusting the motives of this stranger in transit, others not so much. Some offering asylum and welcome into the community, others with ridicule. One of my favorite movies of all time is The Truman Show. Have some of you seen the film The Truman Show? If you haven't seen it, it's just fantastic and you should definitely watch it again. I used to use this film to talk about the experience of becoming a Christian, and now I realize it's really, for me now, this is also about the malleability of stories. I mean, stories can be used in multiple ways, but it really clearly articulates for me the experience of leaving my faith. So let me remind you a little of the contours of this story. and especially for those of you that don't know the story, Truman is born into this TV set. It's a 24-hour cameras on him all the time reality show about this young man. He was born and grows up on the show. And he reaches around the age of late 20s, early 30s, and he experiences some things that cause him to question the world that he lives in, its authenticity, its truthfulness. He begins to notice glitches in the matrix, if you will, problems with the reality that he's been given and the story that he's been told. Things just don't add up. It's just weird things that he begins to notice. Not only was his world constructed for him, that TV set, but his fears were also constructed for him. And he has this profound fear of water. And as it happens, his artificial town is right on a huge ocean, so he thinks. The final point in the movie, Truman is driven by love for a girl that inexplicably vanished from his life. She was one of the cast, and now she's whisked off off the set because they get too close, and it's jeopardizing the narrative. And so he finally overcomes his fear of the water where his father mysteriously drowned years back, and he launches out in a small boat, not even knowing where he's going, not even knowing he's going to arrive anywhere, determined to get off the island and find his love. He overcomes the fear of the unknown and death in search of the truth. The ocean, for Truman, is his liminal space. It's his place of unknowing. It's his place of instability. It's his place of confusion and doubt and fear. And then, of course, the producers kick up a great storm on the sea, and Truman nearly drowns. But the storm finally subsides, and he reaches the edge of his known world. He literally reaches the edge of his known world as his boat bumps into the edge of the set. It's like, get it? Get it? And he gets out of the boat and walks out, and just walks out of that artificial world. And the important part, I think, is him getting past the fear that he had to launch out into the unknown. And there's so many people that are still standing on the shore, toes in the water, not quite sure if they can ask the deep questions about their faith. And if they do, if they'll ever make it back. And if they don't make it back, what they'll find on the other shore, whether it'll be as beautiful, whether it'll be as winsome, whether it'll be as life-giving as what they've left behind. So that's the tension, the ability to stay on the sea long enough to discover what you hope to discover, not to resolve the tension too quickly. Words like truth and evidence and certainty and knowing, these are words for people that are on one shore or the other. They're words of solid ground, of people who have either arrived at a new place of aggregation or much more likely have never left the shore in the first place. Leaving the shore is a terrifying thing. And so part of my hope is that this journey that I've been on would not only inspire people to go on a similar journey, but would give people hope that it's not as terrifying as it seems. But I also hope that people on the far shore, on your side of the shore, would also have a sharper recollection or of your own experience and an appreciation for those that haven't quite got to where you are yet, but who are asking some of the right questions. And if they'll just ask one more question, that's all they need to do today. And then tomorrow they might have the strength to ask one more question. And they might never arrive where you are, and that's okay as well. But as long as people are being honest and truthful and living their lives in whole and productive ways, I think there's room for people to stand in different places around all of these great mysteries that we all seek to understand. I wanted to end by just asking the gentleman at the soundboard to play this song by a band called Quiet Company. This is the song Black Sheep and the Shepherd. And if you've been on this journey, you may recognize the sentiments in this song. Thanks. I'll come back up for questions.
The river's wide that I could not swim across it. So I convinced myself I walked upon the way. The river's wide that I could not swim across it. So I convinced myself I walked upon the way.
Jesus speak to me. Not in any way that I consider speaking, but I bowed my head just the same. Though I did find some tears when they played that song, but for the four right chords I will play along. I've always been that way. It doesn't matter what the lyrics say. Better than fine, but now both my shoulders have started hurting from walking around under such a burden to reconcile everything that we've learned with everything that we were taught. But with all we know now, how can you say, oh, you just gotta take it all on faith and don't think too much, just hush and pray exactly as we.
Say to them are really just as bad. 'Cause the only times I ever thought of suicide, I was waiting on the Lord to direct my life, saying, give me one word, I'll put down the knife, I'll never pick it up again. But luckily I held out long enough to see everybody really makes their own destiny. It's a beautiful thing, it's just you and me, exactly where we belong.
Thank you. So, thanks so much for your attention. I hope that wasn't too dull. It's one of those moments, you know, you're standing there talking, thinking. Anyway, there were some hands for questions. Yeah, here, and then we'll go this way.
I see a distinct parallel between being a an extreme right-wing capitalist and then converting to a humanistic socialism. That conversion, I can see the frustration, you know, and you see that your country is not really into you, you know.
Well, you know, it's interesting because I'm working on another talk about stories and the way stories shape our lives. And the title's very clever. It's We Are Made of Stories. You know, like we talk about being made of star stuff. It's like we're made of stories. And I think we are made of stories. And that story is about the American dream and how it works for us. And the hidden reality is that it's never worked for some people, first of all. And it's even starting to fail for the people who it used to work for. So when that story begins to fail you in the very same way that the Christian story begins to fail some people, you have to kind of go, well, wait a second, what's going on here? And that's a rude awakening. And some people step away from the question in fear, and some people go through it. And I don't know what the difference is always, but yeah, it's a good analogy, I think. Yes.
So picking up on that, we are storytelling animals, and we are tribal. And I've often wondered, people who want to go into religion and feel the need for religion, there's an emotional component to it that they need. The storytelling, the feeling of connecting with others and socializing and so forth. So I wondered how you felt about when someone may go through this luminality period into the secular world. I think as secularists, we don't really have that kind of tribalism. We're together because we believe in reason and science, mm-hmm. but we don't really thrive on a storytelling picture that wants us to be somehow partying and socializing and being connected to. We're a little bit different in that way. So do you think that component is a very difficult one that people in religion have to go through in the luminality?
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, several observations about that. One is, here we all are. So some people are gathering and forming groups. And I actually think it's a challenge for the next phase of, I don't know, call it human social evolution. I mean, because from the time of Socrates, people have been gathering and talking about the things that are most important to them and, mentoring themselves, assigning themselves to a mentor who could help them think in different ways and learn. Because the tricky thing about new thoughts is that you almost can never have a genuinely new thought by yourself. Someone has to introduce that to you, because you can't know, you can't ask a question that you haven't thought to ask, right? There's something has to happen from the outside that makes you go, oh gosh, I never thought of that before. So I think that this, on an intellectual level, is really important. For there to be places where people can cultivate their thinking and their critical thinking skills. But even on a social level, and people are different. Some people are introverts, some people are extroverts, you know. But I think it is important for people to be able to gather if they want to and do good together. And, I mean, I at the very basic level, I would call it democracy, right? Like, democracy requires us to talk to each other. about what's most important. And I think the future of our democracy is really, that's important to that too. Maybe I've missed your point.
Yeah, I think I failed to communicate what I'm trying to say is that it's not the actual socialization, it's the basis of that story of Jesus.
Right.
And that is about humanity and self-sacrifice, and there's a huge emotional component to that. We are bound together by the excitement of learning.
Right.
And reason and science. So we do socialize and we do want companionship, but we are lacking that
story.
Other thing.
I agree. This is a big thing on my mind, because for me, as my faith, my Christian faith, evolved into a very liberal faith, I was much less concerned with what the actual verses said, because I didn't think that they were literally inspired anyway. I was much more interested in the story, the arc of the story. And I think humanism has I don't know. It does. I think you're right. I think it lacks that. I don't know that it needs to necessarily long term. I think the history is a story, like the history of of philosophy, the history of science, that big sweeping. People like David Sloan Wilson do a decent job of like trying to like give that sense of the evolution of human thought as a kind of narrative arc. But that's the work, I think, that we have to do, because it is important. I mean, we do need to find our place in the world, in the story.
Can I just add another thing? I'm sitting next to an author of a book called Angel's Flight, and he does exactly this. Mm. He talks about a character. Well, I'll let Milt, you talk about it.
Well, yeah, it's the coming of age of an atheist. I call it a stealth novel, because you don't know where it's going. But he starts out as a Southern Baptist and goes to theological school and realizes it's all nonsense and meets a lot of people in different religions and finally ends up realizing that it's all nonsense.
Cool. Yeah, I'd love to check it out. Incidentally... We're going to go to people right behind you.
Oh, incidentally, I wrote a movie review, which was published in Atheist United newsletter, about the Truman Show.
Oh, yeah.
And I was saying that it's a parable about the coming, the awakening of an atheist. Mm. He grows up in this fantasy world, and then realizes that there's a reality world outside of it.
I mean, it's really any awakening that any of us go through. Yeah. Yes.
You haven't said where your decision is going to come down, and I don't want to put you on the spot for that. But are there other philosophical foundations that you plan to investigate before you come to a conclusion, or do you think this is pretty much enough?
No, I mean you're never done learning. But like I said, I'm really interested in the narrative development of humanism and how we can continue to cultivate that. I'm also, I would probably want to push back on what I perceive to be a kind of positivism, scientific positivism that I see in the movement. That I'm not completely, partly because I'm a social, like I'm a humanities person. I'm not a scientist, and so that kind of smugness of the movement that my friend wrote to me about, I kind of sense that. I'm interested in exploring, you know, mindfulness and that kind of thing as a spiritual practice, the way Sam Harris writes about it. But I think in terms of arguments for the existence of a deity, there's only so many of them. I mean, there you go, 14. So, you know. And I think people will continue to come down on all sides of it. It really does sometimes depend on, you know, you find what you're looking for to a certain degree. So there will always be people who will find what they're looking for. But I think, there aren't any other major philosophical movements that I'm really driving at. Yeah, in the back, in the middle there.
Ryan, would you restate the question?
Oh, sure, I will. Yeah, sorry about that. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for coming here. First of all, I really appreciated this. I know this is probably a very uncomfortable situation for you, and so, you know, just have the courage to do this. I really appreciate it. Now, I know this is a little naive of me, but I've always believed that both believers and non-believers live their life as secularists, okay? And to give you an example, I just think about the joke that when one's car breaks down, the believer sits in his car and prays for help while the atheist calls for a tow truck. Sort of thing. So what I'm curious is, could you give me an actual example as to how you might live your life differently now as a secularist as when you did when you were a believer?
Yeah, I actually might be more evidence for your hypothesis. One of my early discoveries is that there wasn't a huge difference in the way I live my life. I think I would say that the locus of hope is different, which is not a practice. It's not sort of a thing I would do when I woke up in the morning necessarily, like review where my hope lies kind of thing. Although in a way Christians do that. I mean, that is a part of sort of the centering meditative practice for a Christian, is to sort of kind of every, and I think anybody can do this, sort of when you wake up in the morning, you have a cup of coffee and remember what's really important to you. Remember how you want to live this day, you know, as a peaceful person rather than a violent person, blah, blah, blah. So I think the locus of hope is different. I mean, one of the hardest things for me to adjust to, I think, is it's not so much going to heaven and living forever. I mean, I sort of decided a while back that we were, you know, this was probably it, you know, even though I was still a Christian. But I think it's the idea that, as theologian N.T. Wright likes to say, that the world will be put to rights in the end. You know, that the arc of the universe is actually bending towards justice, like King said. Actually, I think Shermer is about to solve that for us. His next book is called Arc of Morality or something like that. So he's going to, I think, fix that problem, I hope. So, you know, and we'll all realize that the arc is bending towards something good, even though it's not God. But that part is hard, you know, realizing that, yeah, life, you know, has become less violent, you know, over the centuries. People like Steven Pinker have helped us with that. But in general, in my perspective, it still seems pretty, pretty painful. And to know that within the generation of my children and their children, it's probably not going to get a whole lot better for them. It could get worse before it gets better. We might scorch the planet, you know, irrevocably. That sort of thing is kind of hard to think about, even though I won't be here to experience it. So that's tough. And I think just the idea that there's someone to call on, even though this is the weirdest psychology of faith, is that even though you never expect God to do something exactly what you ask him to do, the sense that there's someone there that you could talk to or that would listen to you or that would have compassion on your circumstances, at least, is better than the feeling of being completely alone. At least that's how it feels at first. So I think, you know, not doing that, not having this sense, even though I was never a very rigorous, disciplined prayer, that sense of calling on someone bigger that's reliable, you know, I miss that sometimes. Ugh, what do I do now? Help. Let me go over here and then behind and then we'll see where we go. Sorry, and then back there again. Okay, go ahead.
So in your experience, this liminality, do you think that's actually something somebody needs to go through, or do you think that we need to create some kind of helping hand or some kind of outreach that maybe helps mentor those people who do have those questions? Do you feel like there's a space for us to create something? We are very new in this. A lot of people, you know, we don't have a lot of gatherings, maybe more of a support system.
Right. I agree. I do think so. And people have asked me, what am I going to do next? You know, and I mean, I have a job, which is great. So that's what I'm doing next. I'm going to do my job. I work at PATH, by the way, People Assisting the Homeless. If you drive by it on the 101 freeway, that's us. And I'd be very excited for you to look us up online and learn more about us. So that's what I do with my time. But in terms of this avocation, this sort of religious studies component, I do think that it's important for people to have places to explore those questions. I've been talking to some people who have some online forums that I might investigate next year where I could help people. Others can do that as well. Places like this can do that. Sunday assembly is that for some people. Other gatherings. Because people are not, it was true in Christianity. I would talk to these very conservative, certain Christians, and they would say, this is how it is, and people just need to realize it. And I would say to them, you know, did you just wake up one day and arrive at these ideas? You evolved to these ideas over a long period of time. People are not going to come to where you are. And for me, as a liberal Christian, my frustration was with conservative Christians. I wanted them to wake up and see the truth or the error of their ways. And I was reminded again and again as a pastor that people don't do that generally. People don't just have this sudden awakening. Sometimes they do. The death of a loved one or another type of crisis can put people right over the edge. But a lot of times people are afraid to ask the next question, and if they have a safe place to do that, I think that can be hugely helpful for people. And I think there's a lot of ridicule aimed at religion that's deserving, but it's sort of like, I always think of this parable that I learned when I was a child about a man with a cloak, and the sun and the wind had a debate who could get the guy's cloak off. And so the wind just blew and blew and blew on the guy. And the harder it blew, the more the guy just pulled his cloak around him. And then the sun said, you know, this is simple. And it just sat there and burned. And the guy just very quickly took his cloak off. So I think, you know, sometimes we try to strip people's faith from them. And often it's counterproductive. It makes them go back in a reactionary way. Christians do it too. Like, I remember this apologist whose name I just cannot remember. He has three names and is really annoying. Yes, William Lane Craig. So he did I knew that you would all know. So he did a 30-minute segment just on my year without God. And for 30 minutes, he basically just ridiculed me. He didn't address any of my questions, any of my history, any of my like past experiences, none of that. He just made fun of me, him and his co-host, in this very saccharine, syrupy, you know, spiritual sort of way. And it just made me want to reach through the radio and punch him in the face. And is that being recorded? So I wrote to him a really nice email and said, "Sir, I would love to talk with you." Of course, I never heard back. But his assistant wrote back, or somebody, and I said, "You know, the thing I want to convey to him is this. I'm your low-hanging fruit, right? I am your just a step outside of the faith. Like, you could take a different approach with me. You could be kind to me, for starters. You could be like, I don't know, like Jesus, or like who you think Jesus was to me. You could do that. That would be a good start. And then you could take my question seriously, and we might have a productive conversation. You might even win me back. But instead, you just like, just ridiculed me for half an hour. There's no way in hell I'm listening to what you have to say now." And I think the reverse can also happen. Like, atheists can do the same thing to Christians. Christians who might be open to having a more broad-minded view of the world, even if they stay Christians, but by criticizing them and ridiculing them and making fun of them, and you know, it is awful tempting sometimes, as crazy as some of the things are, we might have a bit more luck getting people to be critical thinkers. Just basic human respect, I think, on all sides. Yes, sir.
For those of us who are unknowledgeable of the Christian sects, can you, in a few sentences, tell us what a Seventh-day Adventist is?
Yeah, I'll make this really unpainful and quick. Yeah, it's Seventh-day Adventism is an American-born religion cropped up in the early to mid 1800s in New England during what was known as the Second Great Awakening. Similar movements that cropped up at a similar time. Most of them have died off, but the Mormons are one as well. I still feel a little defensive for the Seventh-day Adventists. I would not want you to equate them because the Mormons are much crazier. I mean, Adventists have their crazy, don't get me wrong, but the Mormons are like well down the line, like Scientologists, well down the line. And if you haven't seen Book of Mormon, you know, next time it comes around, do yourself a favor. That was a real laugh. But so that's the context. It's American-born, sort of frontier type of religion. Yeah, Methodism was going through a revival at that time too. Oberlin College that was born out of the sort of Great Awakening in Methodism. They took a liberal turn later, which was good for them, but not the Adventists. Yeah, so it's also part of the Restorationist movement in religion. So basically what they did, Restorationists are very interested in getting back to the pristine faith of the apostles. If we could only get back to when Christianity was pure, that concept, right? So what they would do is they would study the Bible to find long-lost truths and that sort of thing. So what they discovered was that the Bible never talks about going to church on Sunday. The Jews received the Sabbath from God and the Ten Commandments, and it was never, according to the Bible, nobody ever changed it. And so the Adventists said, well, then we should be observing Saturday. So they're Sabbatarians, one of the only Sabbatarian Christian groups. And they believe in the very soon coming of Jesus, though that story is getting harder to hold on to the more time goes by. Where was I going to go next? Let me go here in the front. I'll go to both of you.
I just detected a slight flaw in your reasoning or your view of
it. I'm surprised this is the first one, yes.
And that is that all atheists say there is no God. I don't know that that's true. I certainly don't. Mm. I don't believe there is a God. I think it's unlikely, but in some universe, maybe there is.
Sure.
And all the other one is that atheists hate religion. I certainly don't hate religion. I understand it. I know why people become religious, why they believe in God, why they join a religion.
Yeah.
And there's a certain consistency with that, with humanity, with human nature. So I don't think that if you think that all atheists say there is no God, or that they all hate religion, that might color your view of atheism.
Right. No, she's saying that not all atheists, you know, are certain about the non-existence of God. In fact, I would say most atheists are not certain about the non-existence of God. And they're not all hostile towards religion, and that's also very true. So, and in fact, my experience has been, you know, that people have welcomed me And I mean, I'm here today because people have welcomed me. And so I think, yeah, that's very true. I think sometimes, I mean, Richard Dawkins puts it really nicely in that he says sometimes agnosticism passes as the idea that theism or the existence of God is a 50-50 proposition. So I would say most atheists do not think it's a 50-50 proposition. They would say it's more like 99-1, right? Something like that, which sounds pretty certain to me. So, I kind of just want to like color that a little bit. So I think I don't know very many. I probably know fewer people who think God is a 50-50 proposition than any other kind, right? That's the minority, I would say. Either there's people who are more certain there's a God or more certain there isn't. The group in the middle, the 5 or the 4 on Dawkins' scale, whatever it is, that one in the middle, I think that's probably pretty rare. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Seventh-day Adventists, that's the group that believes in no blood transfusion.
That's Christian Science.
No dancing.
Oh, Jehovah's Witness?
That's Jehovah's Witness.
But I think Christian Scientists don't. They're the one, Mary Baker Eddy, they're the ones who don't.
They only pray, no medicine.
Yeah. Right, so medical interventions and that kind of thing. Dancing and all of that, that's kind of a 19th century moralism that was part of the Great Awakening that I was talking about. Card playing, dancing, smoking, drinking, all of those kinds of things were a part of the Methodist movement. The Adventist movement broke off from that. JWs and Mormons all came out of that same time period, so they have the similar sort of moral prohibitions. That. I see our moderator inching towards the stage, so I don't know how much time... Three more questions. Let me go here, and then in the back with the yellow hat. You've been raising your hand for a while. Okay, go.
One thing you, as a Seventh-day Adventist, seem to embrace, or the religion embraces, is vegetarianism.
Right.
A lot of people think that's a day-to-day decision and something that you could actually change your life. I'm wondering if that had anything to do... First of all, are you one? Are you going to stay one? Did you not being one have anything to do with the superiors asking you to leave?
No.
I mean, to the extent that I think that's more moral than this group.
I agree.
Not embraced it. And then compared to, like, Scientologists, they at least detox. The Mormonisms, at least, they give up cigarettes and tobacco. But Seventh-day Adventists go farther. They think it's wrong to eat an animal. What's
right.
your position?
Yeah, so vegetarianism, the prohibition is like the Jewish food laws. That was sort of like the prohibition. Vegetarianism is considered more optional within Adventism, though it was strongly taught. So I grew up not an Adventist. And then when I became an Adventist, I was a vegetarian. And then I was not a vegetarian. And I'm not now. And the reason for that is, I just really like food, but I'm trying.
Like animals.
I know my moral horizon is toward vegetarianism. I don't think it's sustainable for the planet either, but I'm evolving still. So I need a little bit more time. But for me, vegetarianism was tied up within Adventism, it had a very moralistic tone, like God didn't want me to eat meat. So when I started getting pissed off about all of that, I was like, screw it, I'm eating meat. You know, this is an expression of my freedom, you know, from this tyranny. So there's a little bit of a psychological twist for me, but I applaud many of my friends are vegetarian for the right reasons, and I aspire to being morally evolved one day to the point where I would be a vegetarian. Yes, sir.
Can I ask you to step outside the context of religion for just a second and perhaps discuss your views on supernaturalism at large? And has your journey influenced that?
Yeah, gosh, that's a really great question because I wasn't a huge fan of supernatural things when I was a Christian. I just didn't see, although, very interesting, I had an experience. This guy on Facebook, he's my friend on Facebook now. When I was first a pastor, my second year, he was 11 years old. He was diagnosed with a kind of lymphatic cancer that really focuses on little children. It's like a common only among children and very rare at that. And so he went to Philadelphia Children's Hospital. I visited him. I saw the MRIs. There was this tumor the size of an orange in his little skinny body. And we had a prayer for service for him, and he went in for surgery the next day, and it wasn't there, according to the doctor, according to the medical report. That is the only experience I've ever had with anything that I thought, I have no explanation for that. And he's brought it up to me repeatedly, like, well, what about that time? And I was like, I don't know. I mean, I mean, there's a lot of things to say about that. One is that it happened the one time, and why not again, and why not to anybody else? Does God like him best, or what? But it is a bizarre scenario. I don't, you know, Sam Harris in his new book talks about the possibilities of, he just briefly touches on the possibilities of sort of extrasensory types of things with our brains connecting to one another. That kind of thing. He just barely cracks the door open, it seems to me, about that. I'm super agnostic about all that. I'm just a real practical, I was always more Jewish than I was Christian in my anthropology. I prefer to deal with the dirt and the blood and the stuff I can touch and handle, you know? So if that's possible, I'm open to the idea that that could be possible. I just have a hard enough time communicating as it is with the people that I care about. I can just imagine the complexity if I could communicate I don't think humans are ready for that. Yes, sir.
Do you have any feeling how many or what percentage of your former colleagues or colleagues have similar doubts? I mean, you've been out for a year now, so you're kind of on the radar. So do people come up to you, people of the clergy of various faiths, and say, well, you know, I can't really say anything, but I'm kind of with you there?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. Religion is, the more I step back from it, the more I see that religion is about 90% public relations. And so there's a big fear about what's happening with the nuns, the N-O-N-E-S in America. And churches, even very liberal churches like the Episcopal Church, are doubling down on their kind of, well, yeah, sure, we don't believe in a God with a, you know, ontology. We believe in God as the ground of being, the thing that unites us all, kind of an Oprah Winfrey kind of, we're all connected type of thing. And I'm happy to say that we're all connected somehow, you know, but we can, it doesn't have to be God, you know. So anyway, I think there's, even the liberal churches are concerned about that, and they're very reluctant, was what I'm trying to say, to admit that they have similar questions and doubts. Though I do have a few colleagues who have come up to me and said, yeah, I mean, I struggle with doubts too. I just choose to believe. And in a way, it is like saying, like you said, step outside of religion for a minute and analyze this from, you know, and then when I stepped into atheism, people said I was doing it wrong or that I couldn't really do that. And I would say, like, no, you can do that. Like, you could take a week and step inside a Christian worldview and try to think of the world through a Christian lens if you wanted to, if you tried hard to do that. If you were really good at being honest with yourself and saying, okay, I'm going to take this seriously. I'm going to pray for 30 days and see what happens, that kind of thing. So I think that people are really reluctant to confess those doubts, even though they have them privately, especially someone who's experiencing this very publicly. I think some people are just worried I'm going to write about them on my blog. But I would never do that, of course, unless I had their permission. But I've had people say to me, like, wait, you're not going to write about me on your blog, right? Right before they're about to tell me their story. And I'm like, no. What do you think? I mean, this is just unethical, right? To, like, tell somebody's story on a public forum without their permission. But so people are a little concerned about that. People that are not clergy are much freer to say, gosh, I don't even know, like, I've felt this way forever. I'm so glad you would say that. But clergy they're protecting the institution and their jobs and everything too. And that's easy to be flippant about that, but that's also a reality. Like, I lost my job and I was unemployed for a year. It's not an easy thing. I think, you know, the clergy project is a big, well, it's a little window. I mean, there's a lot of people, but we don't all get to look into it, which is good. People there who, some of them are still in their pulpits. I've been corresponding with an Adventist pastor who's been on a leave of absence for a while, and he's got to make a decision this month about what he's going to do. So a lot of people like me shared what they believed by silence, in a way. So I would preach about things I believed in, and I would simply not preach about things I didn't believe in. And so by silence, I would avoid topics that I didn't want to get into. So I didn't believe that Jesus was coming any minute now. So you wouldn't hear me giving a sermon about how Jesus is going to be coming any minute now. And some people could read between the lines and see those things and say, oh, I wonder if he really believes that. But most people aren't. They're coming to church for the same reason that any of us go to any inspirational thing. They wanted to hear something that would give them sort of a philosophical orientation to the world. So I think people are scared it's a big, this liminality is a big deal. And I went through it personally, but what I also was trying to say is that the whole country is going through this. And the people on shore A, who are the certain ones about Christianity, are holding really tightly to people trying to make a real war out of this so they won't venture out. And then people are scared, and you know, there's a lot at stake. There's a lot of money at stake, there's a lot of institutions at stake, people's lives are at stake, there's a lot on the line. So I give people a lot of grace in terms of, you know, forcing them to do that. But maybe after the year is over and it's more like resolve, people might come up to me. We'll see. Thanks.